Please get ready for a dictation of exercise number 17 from April 2021 issue of Progressive Magazine. 5 seconds. Start. Mr. President, when I received your invitation to inaugurate this, the 39th annual session of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, I was somewhat hesitant in accepting it. I was aware that since independence, each annual session of the Federation has been inaugurated by the Prime Minister. This, in fact, was the main reason for my reluctance. These annual meetings are beginning to become almost a ritual, and I am not much of a believer in rituals. I am also not happy about the tendency to turn to the Prime Minister to inaugurate every function of importance and to consider that a function which is not inaugurated by the Prime Minister is only of second-rate importance. I feel strongly that other cabinet ministers, as also people in public life outside officialdom, should perform such functions far more frequently than they are at present doing. Your experience will always be useful. Within the ranks of industry, the younger group feels that it is not fully playing its part. I have often spoken of my intention to keep in touch with the younger generation. I am calling together some younger industrialists, technicians, and managers from both the private and public sectors to discuss concrete and specific problems within the broad framework of our basic objectives. It will be a sharing of thought and perhaps evolving of new ideas. Dynamic changes are needed now in attitudes and functions. In your address, Mr. President, you have pointed out that India is still a depressingly poor country and expressed concern that we have not succeeded well enough in our effort to fight poverty and develop our economy. Poverty is indeed the central problem facing us, and it is the way in which we set out to tackle it that we as a nation will be judged. It is a long and arduous battle that we have to wage. It calls for clarity of purpose, for determination, for unity. It demands of us all the perseverance, the discipline, the hard work of which we are capable. Slowly and steadily, we shall be building a new and progressive nation in which even the poorest in our country will be able to enjoy a minimum level of living. There will be fuller employment, more widespread facilities of education and health, greater opportunities for youth, and less inequalities of income and wealth. After you had shown so clear a recognition of the challenge of our situation, I was a little disappointed. Mr. President, to hear you suggest that we would be well advised to have a smaller fourth plan. After a detailed analysis of all the relevant considerations and a recognition of the limits of the possibilities open to us, one may come to any conclusion about the size of the plan. But to suggest and propagate that a smaller plan is desirable for its own sake, and that it may even help in our fight against poverty, is not convincing. There is no question in my mind that we have to mobilize our resources to the limit of our capacity and use these human and material resources in a coordinated and efficient manner. If we shirk the responsibility and seek to cover it up by phrases, we shall be merely paying lip service to the cause of the common man. It is not with caution and circumspection that we can win the war against poverty, but by our capacity to take risks and to accept burdens and responsibilities. This does not mean that we should not take the greatest possible care in the husbanding of our resources. I am anxious to seek advice on the methods by which we could achieve a higher rate of growth in our economy and ensure better performance in every sector of our activity with lower investment or input of resources in general. I do not deny that our performance in the recent past has fallen short of our expectations. We could have done better in many directions. However, let us not belittle our achievements. There is much in our record of the last three plans of which we can legitimately be proud. Let us not forget that the current level of industrial production is nearly twice of what it was in 1955, and we produce a large range of commodities which we did not produce before. The output of food grains increased by 70% between 1959-61 and 1964-65. Let us not ignore the great progress in education, especially primary education and technical education. New skills have been developed. Science and technology are making their presence felt in distant villages. Much of the frustration which exists in the Indian economy today and which you have voiced flows from the fact that the performance of the third plan has fallen short of our hopes. Let us, by all means, learn from our mistakes and attempt to correct them to best of our abilities and resources. Stop.